topic is on thrombocytopenia. It will be delivered by Dr. Serian Subhash. Let me quickly introduce Dr. Serian Subhash. He is an MBBS from Stanley Medical College, 1996, and has done his MRCP, completed in 2003, and he is an FRCPAT in 2008. He is director and head of the Department of Institute of Hematology. So we have two hematologists today. Right? So then he is also a transplant director and consultant hematologist, Queen Center for Oncology and Hematology, Castle Hill Hospital, UK, until 2012. Specialist Register in Hematology, Yorkshire Rotational Training Program. That's about 2009. So he has lots of proficiency in pharmacology, physiology, and has honors in several board exams and things like that. He's a member of the Royal College of Pathologists, Royal College of Physicians, London, and British Society of Hematology. Quite happy to introduce you, Dr. Subhash. Welcome.
Thanks a lot. It's been a pleasure to be invited to speak to such an august audience. And someday I could see such eminent doctors in Chennai Assembly for continuing education is good, and I'm proud to have such education scanning on. I've heard from various people that IMA Kodamakam has a continuous academic program for past many decades, not even years.
And 36 years.
36 years. That's impressive. I'm impressive achievement, and it's been an honor to speak to you. I'm Dr. Serian Subhash. I'm a consultant hematologist and transplant physician at New York Hospital, Chennai. And I've been talked to speak on thrombocytopenia, which I think probably is the most topical, as we have the dengue season hitting us very soon. And almost half the hospital beds, whether in the private or the public sector, is all filled by patients with probable thrombocytopenia. Just an introduction, just to have a couple of slides for patients to get the discussion going. A 21-year-old female with a few days of fever. The fever has settled down but presented with myalgia, abdominal pain. A complete hemogram shows a hemoglobin of 14 grams. Quite unusual for a 21-year-old female, as you would expect. They would be slightly iron deficient or anemic, but hemoglobin of 14.3, slightly high hematocrit, with mild leukopenia and the relative lymphocytosis, and a profound thrombocytopenia. The blood smear shows thrombocytopenia with atypical lymphocytes. This, if you show to any of the hematologists, the classic one, they say that this looks like a viral thrombocytopenia. If you show it to any hematologist throughout the world, it could be viral thrombocytopenia. But if you show it to any hematologist or general physicians or any primary care providers in India, this has to be dengue, unless proved otherwise. It was dengue. This patient had a high NS1 antigen and a high IgM, but just about a borderline IgG for dengue. And this could be a variety of reason for thrombocytopenia in viral illness. And predominantly there are two pathways which the thrombocytopenia can be present in viral illness, also in dengue. It's enhanced platelet destruction and decreased platelet production. Enhanced platelet destruction could be like in immune thrombocytopenia, where there are autoimmune antibodies against your home platelets, but also can be decreased production. There are newer data that emerges that dengue, unfortunately, has a direct toxicity on the megakaryocytes, which produces profound thrombocytopenia. But generally, they are self-limiting, and so don't go on to have sustained thrombocytopenia in some of the viral infections, which can develop into chronic IgP. But a direct infection of the megakaryocytes or an autoantibody. And more recently, thrombopoietin receptors, toxicity of thrombopoietin inhibition can also be produced by the viral pathogen dengue. And the typical clinical features of dengue in combined with laboratory changes along with your microbiological viremias is basically spread across a week. The infection, initial infection to the end of critical phase almost takes about a week, 10 days. And that's the crucial, the in-between phase is the crucial period where people succumb to the disease. The initial febrile illness lasts for about a few days, 3 to 4 days, and when the patient actually is better, the critical phase of the dengue starts, where there is many times is asymptomatic. This girl who came into our unit was actually asymptomatic, and just because they have done an NS1 antigen and a dengue antigen previously, they came in. When she came in, her platelet counts were normal, but the next day it took the platelet to profoundly drop. So the critical phase of the illness starts about 3 to 4 days after the initial symptoms, and particularly the first apoaxial day. By a week, 8 days, the recovery starts to happen. And if you have a laboratory which follows up the viremia, you can see initially the red cells, the white cells, and the platelets all remain normal. And by third, fourth day, there is a precipitous fall in. There is a precipitous fall in the platelet count, which is the green one. By third, fourth day, from nearly normal to sudden drop to moderate and sometimes to severe thrombocytopenia is what happens. And that thrombocytopenia is part of a bigger cytokine syndrome, which includes disseminated intravascular coagulation, multi-organ dysfunction, deranged LFTs, and these actually cause the dengue hemorrhagic fever phase. And by a week, 8 days, 9 days, your platelet count comes back to normal. The hematocrit generally goes up due to the capillary leak, and when there is an ongoing hemorrhagic fever, the blood starts to fall down and you can get severe anemia and sometimes even a significant hemorrhagic shock, which precipitately drops the hemoglobin. The initial idea of a high hemoglobin suddenly gives away to a profound anemia could be associated with hemorrhagic shock. As with any viral infection, there is leukopenia with relative lymphocytosis, which improves over a period of time. And the bottom one, the bottom curve, shows the viremia and the serological response to dengue is characteristic, which helps us to diagnose at what stage the dengue infection is there. The initial viremia makes your NSM antigen goes up. That is, if you do it on the first day of your viral illness or the second day of your viral illness, you probably will have only the NS1 antigen positivity with little change in IgM and IgG antibody. But as the disease progresses, you will start some serological response to the dengue antigen with a gradually increasing IgM, and IgG still hasn't made its presence yet. So you will have an NS1 antigen slightly starting to drop. The IgM starts to go in the middle phase of the illness, and IgG, which is supposed to be a neutralizing antibody and gives prolonged immunity, starts to come probably by the end of the critical phase, by the time the critical phase is already over. So unfortunately, in dengue, many of them are non-protective antibodies because of the strain of dengue associated with it. There are 4 strains, which 2 of them are the serious ones, and there is no cross-reactivity to any of them. And in fact, if you have an earlier strain of dengue, the subsequent strain of dengue can be more hemorrhagic, as the body thinks that there is some protection to the initial strain, but actually produces a serious dengue hemorrhagic fever. And can be, I mean, one of the biggest problems in many centers which admit dengue is the paucity of platelets and the use of platelets in dengue hemorrhagic fever. Can we reduce the amount of platelet transfusion, which is a precious commodity? It's got a very short shelf life. So we can't keep on increasing, giving platelets and other things. Single donor platelets are all used, but there is a limitation to all of them. So if you have, as with any immune thrombocytopenia or a recovering bone marrow, you will find, as Dr. Krishnathan was telling about, the reticulocyte count that go close-up with hemolytic anemias or any recurrent in bone marrow. Platelet can also be measured using an immature platelet fraction similar to the reticulocytes. The normal range is up to 6 to 9%. But in a lab which has got a five-part analysis and there is a technique to measure the immature platelet functions, you can see that the immature platelet fractions can go up gradually. If it is around 30-40%, as this graph shows, as this shows, you can expect the platelet count to be recovering in a day or maybe within the next day, except it probably will go up. So you can hold off your platelet transfusion if you want to be brave enough to and basically get the patients on your side. Next is probably a 14-year-old male, fever for 2 days, has nosebleeds. But incidentally, if you ask more about this history, the nosebleeds actually precedes the fever. So the nosebleed was essentially unrelated to the fever. But with anything, this patient also came to us with symptoms of dengue. And the hemoglobin was normal, white cells were normal, platelets were profoundly low at 4,000. The blood smear was basically normal with no other features apart from thrombocytopenia, As with anything, this we don't need a bone marrow examination in all of them, but this is a bone marrow biopsy from somebody else with an immune thrombocytopenia. You can see plenty of these big cells, the megakaryocytes. Immune thrombocytopenia has got no other features apart from raised megakaryocytes or normal megakaryocytes in many situations with ITP. This is immune thrombocytopenia. As the patient had, the dengue serology was negative. The rest of the white cells, the peripheral smear, were all normal. The third one is a 40-year-old male, presents with a lot more symptoms than the previous one, with fever on and off for the past few weeks, general bruises, in fact has gum hypertrophy and nosebleeds, presents with a hemoglobin of 9, a raised white cell count, and there was plaques all over. You could see a neutrophil count of around 10%, and the rest of the ones are unclassified, and a platelet of 15,000. The blood smear shows atypical mononuclear cells and thrombocytopenia, and that's the peripheral smear of that gentleman. And this is probably the most serious of all of them, even discounting dengue during those critical hemorrhagic fever. This probably has got a death sentence on his hands. He has got a, these are, there is one mature neutrophil and there is absolutely no platelets in its peripheral smear, and the other nucleated cells have a high nucleocytoplasmic ratio. This is a myeloblast and this patient had an acute myeloid leukemia. So thrombocytopenia could be normal in a variety of viral infections, or it could be serious illness like acute leukemia, but many times out of 10, you will have a patient who has got mild immune thrombocytopenia or a viral-induced illness, which many times spontaneously resolves or at least stays in a stable phase without any major incidences. So just a quick recap of your thrombocytopenia. The thrombocytopenia could be due to a decreased production or increased destruction. The two major mechanisms. The increased destruction could be immune or non-immune. The immune ones are what I said is immune thrombocytopenia or drug-induced thrombocytopenia. In particular, patients who have been exposed to lots of heparin and low molecular weight heparins as well can produce heparin-induced thrombocytopenia. Post-transfusion purpura, which is an immune cross-reactivity and allo-reactivity to your home platelets, and any connective tissue disorders could be part of your secondary immune thrombocytopenia. Non-immune thrombocytopenia could be due to microangiopathic hemolytic anemia. Microangiopathic hemolytic anemia means it's a small vessel destruction of platelets and consumption of platelets. Could be part of your thrombotic thrombocytopenic malaria or TDPs. And a preeclampsia, which is one of the commonest ones, which we will see in our obstetric practice, or it could be a part of a multi-organ dysfunction or a disseminated intravascular coagulation. Decreased production could be either an inherited or an acquired one. inherited bone marrow failures, quite a few families, quite a lot of inherited bone marrow failures, which are quite rare and is a trick, but it could be also due to acquired causes like aplastic anemias or infiltrative disorders like metastatic malignancies or hematological malignancies. Sometimes can be associated with consumption from the spleen, could be from cytopenia, from splenic sequestration. And the essential one is that one of the thrombocytopenia, which is a laboratory error, artifactual thrombocytopenia. The best test for thrombocytopenia is, as Dr. Krishnaratham said, there is nothing better than a good peripheral smear. You do a good peripheral smear, you diagnose most of the problems of hematology. If it is a true thrombocytopenia, there are quite a lot of algorithms which you can do to do a complete hemogram, Coombs test, the LDH, bone marrow biopsy, quite a lot of tests which you can do, but a good peripheral smear properly examined by an experienced laboratory personnel or a hematologist would be very useful, or a pathologist would be very useful. If it is a platelet clumping or artifactual thrombocytopenia, which can be associated with EDTA and other things, repeat the platelet count. I'm sorry, I haven't, there's quite a lot of things we can go on talking about IDP and all those things, but essentially idiopathic thrombocytopenia was replaced by immune thrombocytopenia from the seminal work of Harrington and Hollingsworth proving antiplatelet antibodies, but I will quickly skip through as we have all discussed about thrombocytopenia. We use steroids at 1 milligram per kilogram for the ITP, but most of the immune thrombocytopenia over a period of 6 months to 12 months generally don't bleed, and only 10% need active treatment. Generally doesn't spontaneously resolve, generally doesn't spontaneously, but has a platelet count of 30 to 40,000, which is eminently compatible with normal life for a prolonged period of time. So there are, could be emergency, that's one thing which we all have to deal with. A patient comes in with an emergency, chronic IGP with a needing some trauma and surgery intervention. You can use high-dose methylprednisolone, you can use platelet transfusion, or you can do an emergency splenectomy. We use anti-D as well, but the amount of anti-D available in India is very small and mostly consumed by the obstetricians. But IVIGs are good ones. They take about 24 hours to respond. In the meantime, you can use platelet transfusions as an adjunct. The platelet antibodies which act against your own platelets will act against the transfused platelets as well. So there is no significant advantage of giving platelets in a higher platelet count, but if you still have a serious life-threatening bleeding, probably platelet transfusions frequently might tide over the crisis till you have a plan to increase the platelet count, either by high-dose methylprednisolone or intravenous immunoglobulin. So an algorithm for treating ITP. We have, as I said, steroids, immunoglobulins can be used, splenectomy, rituximab, and a newer thrombopoietin receptor agonist can all be used for IDP. We just list most of them. And these are the newer ones, the thrombopoietin receptor agonists, which are romipastin and entromopag, act through the JAK-STAT pathway and are very helpful in refractory IDP scars. And that's me. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Any questions?
In dengue, the quantity of platelets, the quality of the platelets is more important than the quantity of platelets.
Yeah, I mean, the platelets which we, as I said to you, the immature platelet fraction which I said, are the IPF being more tells you that this is all newly produced platelets, which are generally bigger and quite juicy, and they have a better activity than your prolonged platelets. But Unfortunately, this is a purely what's called a toxicity from the target virine, yeah? And the platelet themselves are generally okay. So if you be able to sustain a platelet count for a period of 2-3 days, I think you generally will be okay. Like, unlike the other infiltrative disorders like metastatic malignancies or hematological neoplasms or myelodysplastic syndromes, which don't have a adequate platelet functions. In particular, uremias and other things have a really poor platelet functions. But this one generally are okay. And particularly it was the later part of the illness and the marrow recovers, these platelets are generally very active.
What step, how can he improve their platelet count by way of food?
This has been a question which has been asked multiple times, and I really don't have any scientific explanation for using, say, nilarengol, carvacrol. There is really don't have any significant scientific evidence. But generally, many of these things, dengue being a self-limiting illness, if it takes 2 days of your cerebral to work, the marrow probably has already recovered. But that's me speaking as a hematologist. You ask my wife, she will give nilarengol kashayam and carvacrol. It doesn't matter what I say. So there is probably some truth to any of them, but unfortunately, dengue being a third world disease, you will never get anybody to do research on it unless we do it.
What is the role of a bone marrow soup?
I suppose that this is we are calling almost like a xenograft, is it? We still haven't replicated lamb into our bone marrow. I presume both are antigenically very different, but any nutrition would be fine, I suppose. That's like a xenograft, is it not, sir? You get a lamb's broth with, in a human being, probably doesn't have much evidence as such.
Dr. Karpa, sir.